Thank you everyone for coming. Please have a seat if you'd like. It's quite wonderful to see everybody here together. So why are we at Highways? We're at Highways because Jacki, early in her career, and many of us here in the audience, did a lot of work here, and Jacki was an incredible writer and wrote about so much of it. But basically, thank you all very much for coming, whether you're here on Zoom. Our Zoom humans are here. Bruce, can you switch up? We have a lot of people visiting from on Zoom as well. So, hey, everybody. So glad. Hey, Meredith. Hi. It's great to see everybody. So we're here to celebrate and honor the life of Jacki as we gather together to share stories and memories and remember our dear friend, colleague, and mentor. I know she meant so much to everyone here. To me, Jacki was a great friend and mentor. For me, she was also the queen of determination and intellect. She advised me in countless ways, both professionally and personally, and was a powerful presence in my life and my family's life. She came to our Thanksgivings, always made the most amazing butternut squash soup every year, and engaged with our kids over the years. She was like an auntie to them. She was extended family. To me, there isn't a word for what she was to me. She was a practicing Buddhist, and in the spirit of mindfulness, I would like to start this gathering with a quote from the great Buddhist teacher, Thich Nhat Hanh. I was just taught how to do this, so let's see if it works. When you hear the bell, this is Thich Nhat Hanh's quote, when you hear the bell, we practice listening to the bell deeply. Listen, listen, listen. This wonderful sound brings me back to my true home. Rest in peace, Jacki.
One time when we take our final breath, and another time when our names are mentioned for the last time from another person, that our spirits live on as long as people remember us. And Jacki, your spirit is alive today, this afternoon. And we're infusing this little rock that I got from Joshua Tree. That's where Jacki's buried. And you know, Joshua Tree is a sacred place. And we're infusing this rock today with all these vibrations, Jacki energy. And then we're going to place this little rock infused with Jackie's sacred energy on her grave site in Joshua Tree. And when it cools down a little bit. And perhaps we can, some of us can do a little performance for Jackie. Jackie loved performance, you know. So, hey, all right. So Jackie, the spirit of Jackie, we're going to infuse this little rock. So here we go. We're going to move this mic here. And hey, so let's let the energy flow here. It is my honor to introduce Jackie's sister, who flew all the way out here from the Bay Apple, New York City. Please, Margie Bank.
Thank you, John. Wonderful as usual. Brilliant, extraordinary, remarkable, exceptional, memorable, generous, magnanimous, assertive, controlled, disciplined, focused, self-assured, self-confident, self-reliant, courageous, feisty, and yes, sometimes even judgmental. As her sister, longtime confidant, and unconditional admirer, these are only a few of the words that I could use to describe Jackie. The big question, how did Jackie become Jackie? We were the baby boomer generation. We grew up in the 1940s on the Upper West Side of Manhattan and moved to New Jersey suburbs in 1953. Our father was an avid reader and history buff, a philatelist, a dabbler in art, a talented violinist, and a small business owner. Our mother was a brilliant Scrabble player, a Hallmark card poet, and homemaker. She served on the first female jury in New York State. They were loving, supportive, and caring parents. But the greatest gift our parents gave us, however, was each other. We grew up together. We grew old together. We laughed together. We cried together. And we shared our secrets together. And we relived our most intimate moments together. She was my tutor and my mentor, my companion and my confidant, my friend and my staunch supporter. I idolized her. Sharing a bedroom for 17 years, we had intimate nighttime conversations about everything from boys to music to philosophy and self-awareness. She was always two steps ahead of me. Jackie first exhibited her brilliant mind and ability as a wordsmith in elementary school, being one of only two sixth graders to pass the Hunter College admissions test. But it was my grandmother who was the greatest influence in Jackie's childhood and teen years. French-born, she was brought to the U.S. by her well-connected and financially successful brother in 1909. She was married and widowed, spent 2 years with my mother in Paris, and returned to Manhattan to work as a children's clothing designer and later as a custom lingerie designer. She was smart, independent, creative, and opinionated. Jackie was the perfect granddaughter. She, like my grandmother, had a French sensibility. My sister's most indelible childhood memory was a trip to Washington, D.C. with my grandmother to visit with her prominent relatives, heirs to intellectual, social, and humanitarian causes. Among them, American financier and advisor to U.S. presidents, Bernard Baruch, and patron of the arts, Peggy Guggenheim. The trip was an aha moment for Jackie. It gave her a glimpse of her potential. It set a course for her feminist future. She was only 13. Jackie came into her own in the 1960s as a fashion designer, artist, and curator, inquisitive, insightful, and adventurous. Meeting and marrying pop artist Billy Apple changed the direction of Jacki's life, broadening her worldview, her friendships, and her ambitions. Jacki, always an avid reader, spurred by curiosity and driven by critical analysis, became all about creative process, cutting through the noise to seek the truth as she saw it. The importance of biodiversity, equality, and humanity. She always gave forward. Her move to LA was crucial for her career. But I leave it to the other speakers to sing her praises as an artist, writer, critic, teacher, and mentor. I am, however, forever indebted to all of Jacki's friends and colleagues for supporting her throughout her long creative career. I know she cherished each and every one of you. She will be greatly missed, especially by me. But let us today celebrate her amazing life, her long list of brilliant accomplishments, and her generosity and humanity. My dear friend, her dear friend Stuart told me that Jacki, in her 2017 essay, Peripheral Visions, started with a six-word sentence that, and I quote, captures the angst and ethos of our times. Whoever controls language determines the future. Think about it. Whoever controls language determines the future. Let us all hope that Jacki's legacy of words and deeds will help dispel some of the dystopian authoritarianism, egotism, and dehumanization rampant in our present culture. To my best friend, my extraordinary sister, Jacki, thank you for always sharing your remarkable life with me.
Margie, thank you. And up next, we are going to go to Zoom if you want to watch that big screen there. And we are going to go to Martha Wilson, zooming in from the East Coast. Martha?
Hello. Jacki Apple and I met each other in 1973 when Lucy Lepard included works by both of us in her number show, America 7500, which originated in Valencia, California, population circa 7500. I saw that Jacki was doing work about female identity, as I was. So I wrote her a letter, and we developed a collaboration presented in December 1973 entitled Transformance, a performance for which we invented an ideal female character. Then we took her to lunch at the Palm Court in the Plaza Hotel and to the galleries in Soho. Jacki, who had a career in New York in fashion design, was completely happy and relaxed throughout this process. While I, the newbie artist living in Halifax, Nova Scotia, Canada, was anxious that we would be discovered as imposters. In 1974, after my boyfriend dumped my ass, I moved to New York City, and Jacki helped me to found Franklin Furnace Archive, Inc. as a venue for the downtown practice being ignored by the uptown institutions. Artist books, temporary installation, and performance art. Jacki invited Eric Bogosian to do his first performance. She selected Jenny Holzer, who presented truisms in Franklin Furnace's storefront window in 1978. And she curated group shows such as workbooks, notebooks, scripts, and scores. Jacki had already had experience running an art space. She helped her husband, Billy Apple, run Apple from 1969 to 1975. And in 1981, she curated a show for the new museum entitled Alternatives in Retrospect and Historical Overview, which examined seven alternative spaces. Gain ground, Apple, 98 Green Street, 112 Green Street Workshop, 10 Bleecker Street, Idea Warehouse, and 3 Mercer Street Store. Jacki Apple was a downtown scene queen for her whole life. Thank you.
Martha. And now we have Linda Albertano coming up to the podium. Linda Albertano, one of Jackie's best pals and performance partners, who would like to share?
You love X-ray world. Thank you. Great. In the 80s and beyond, Jacki Apple was friend, collaborator, and cheerleader, chronicling our achievements in the LA Weekly, High Performance Magazine, and other art journals. It was a time when we ran in packs, and cafes like the Rose in Venice or Gorky's downtown were watering holes for all of us. We coalesced around Lynn Hixon to mount extravaganzas in her loft on horseback at Claremont train station. And memorably, a college campus lit at night by a semicircle of car headlamps. It was the cast of Swayback, Lynn's opus in Santa Monica, which under the tutelage and inclusion of Jacki, became the nonprofit group Cactus, LA's answer to the East Coast's Mabu Mines. Among the several members were Alicia Shapiro of LA's Nihilist Olympics fame and performer extraordinaire Molly Cleeter. Anna Homler and I rounded out the group with Lynn, Jacki, and others. Even Rachel Rosenthal had joined for a time. Many of us were graduates of Rachel's DBD Do By Doing workshops, which she led with her faithful rodent companion, Ratty, on her shoulder. Jacki curated many a performance in local museums, art schools, and venues around town. We orbited with the Dark Bob, John Fleck, Reba Garrison, and Philip Littell at Lace, New Langton Arts, Sushi, and local pop spots like Lhasa, Lingerie, Largo, and the Anti-Club. Jacki also put together a piece for the beach at Santa Monica in which each of the members of Cactus presented a unique work to the beach-going public. I'd also created a piece called Mercenary Children, performing with neighborhood kids at the Lhasa Club and at an anniversary lineup at Highways, which she later arranged to have reprised on the Blue Line for the edification of passengers riding the rails. She especially loved radio art. In the mid-80s, we performed a prescient multi-part piece with Keith Antar Mason and Akilah Nio Oliver on KPFK entitled Redefining Democracy in America, Episodes in Black and White. Later, we played the recording in the dark here at Highways with the audience lying on mats and pillows on the floor. Jacki also adored cats, Sachi and Koji being her latest. And remember Red Rider? I have a single memory, like a snapshot from a long forgotten film. It was 40 years ago at a John White workshop. Jacki is lying, eyes closed, on a table in the center of his studio. were gathered around like mourners at a funeral home. Anaham appears at her tenderly and asks, what will become of her cats? Knowing well that it would be a considerable concern for Jacki. And now, though she lies in state under Joshua trees and stars, we're still lit. With internal resurrections of her underlying New York accent, her bemused laughter, and her incandescent intelligence. Our world is smaller without her. And she's vitally, vitally missed.
Thank you, Linda. That's beautiful. And now on the big old video screen, we're going back to Zoom. I believe we have Jeff McMahon from upstate New York, if I'm not mistaken. Jeff McMahon?
Are you there?
There's Jeff McMahon. Hi, Jeff. Jeff, you might want to unmute. Unmute.
I've been doing this for 2 years and like I forgot how to unmute myself. People should be grateful for that. Having just moved back to New York, the artistically ancestral home of Jacki Apple, after 21 years in Arizona in a job I never would have been offered had it not been for Jacki and others and some of you out there, encouragement and support of my performance career in the 1980s, 1990s, I'm thinking of those mentors, fellow artists, critics, producers, with Jacki blending all of those roles, who made openings for me and for so many others in the art and performance bazaar, both meanings of that word. I snuck back to school in my late 30s to finish my BA and then an MFA, partially due to having witnessed Jacki fighting to get the pay, the position, the respect she deserved because she lacked a terminal degree. Ultimately, Jacki triumphed because she was Jacki, being recognized by College Art Association for her teaching and then becoming the first emeritus at Art Center. But it didn't come easy. Jacki was a resource and a river. She troubled the waters with an endless flow of ideas and provocations. There was no time out or pause or whatever with Jacki Apple. She was rigorous and relentless, but she produced as much as she prodded. She created as much as she commented. Yeah, she dissed on occasion, but she distributed the diverse work of so many other artists far and wide through her reviewing, her radio show, her relentless reminder that what we were doing was and is important. Pay attention. One may be a solo performance artist, but you're not in this alone. Jacki was an exemplar of the critic artist, the artist as critic, as essayist, as educator. One had to be armed with very good reasoning, logic, and experience to contradict her. I think this was because she had to assert, as so many women do, that yes, she did know a lot, could do a lot, and did not need correction. Thank you very much. She understood self-presentation as performance. Back in the 1980s, many of us tried to look as if we just staggered out of a monochromatic war zone, but with ambitious hair. Jacki had much more imagination, more nerve. She'd swan into exhibitions and performances in underfunded venues, looking like $1 million, which a few of my colleagues assumed she had, and I had to correct them on that. No, she had style. She wasn't afraid of showing it. Jacki was fearless, ferocious, finely tuned, and gloried in the visual, the vivid, the alive. Life is an exhibition, an exploration, not something to be stuffed into a closet and only dreamed about or worn later. I can put this on, and I will, right now, not later. When we collaborated on Palisade in the late 1980s, Jacki charged through all-day writing sessions, several of them. I can't do that. Not then, not now. I could never keep up with her. She could track multiple strands of narrative in a way that astounds me still, zeroing in on the particular moment, word, sound, always dynamic and evolving. I'm looking at the publications, CDs, cassette tapes, books of her work, and I'm thinking that she was restless in her exploration of formats and forums. And if one didn't exist she'd form it, thinking of her redefining democracy in America project, for example. I'm glancing at the shelf of my own work, much of which exists because Jacki got someone to pay attention to me. Jacki gave me, an erratically educated and unsure young artist, a language and a context. She made sure that I knew that I mattered. She brought me aboard with others. She made us all a part of a larger voyage in art, an adventure she launched for so many of us. Thank you, Jacki.
Thank you, Jeff. Thank you. And we're still sticking with Zoom here. We're going to, and forgive me if I mispronounce this, Philippa Blair? Or is it Philippa? Philippa, oh man, my bad, sorry. Philippa, forgive me.
Philippa Blair.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Talking to you from New Zealand, Auckland. With Jacki has actually stayed in this room in one of her visits here, but I wanted to say that I have known her for really more than 40 years, both in the USA and in New Zealand. And we met, except I didn't really meet her because I was too shy to talk to her, but she gave a talk in Auckland in 1975 when she was visiting with her then husband, Billy Apple, to Auckland, and she had an exhibition and they had a traveling around the country. But it was lovely to see Martha Wilson's face today because she was one of the artists in the talk that Jacki had given in a slide presentation. And I had never seen such a generosity of spirit in such a woman as Jacki. I mean, she just had the most extraordinary inspiration and vision. And through her, when I came to live in Los Angeles a few years later, she was really the most extraordinary generous person in introducing me to all the right people and all the very best things, and had to dress up if I was going out with her. And anyway, she just was a very beautiful, super intelligent woman with an acerbic wit. And we had fun together. She lived a very full life. And again, when I was in New York a few years later, we actually met and clicked, and we just had a most wonderful time together. So much fun. Meeting friends, going to shows. She introduced me to her performance art world. I was originally very interested in all of her things, but I had a background, I suppose, in dance, music, and fine arts. And now I regularly am a painter. But when we packed her work and she shifted to LA, I stayed with her and on several of my meetings in Los Angeles. And we went to the Santa Monica Market, and we really enjoyed just having time out. She never really stopped. She was very exhausting, but then she said I was too. So the interesting thing is about friendship is that it fluctuates. Sometimes you don't see that person for a long time, but the loyalty was unshakable, and that's something that I will always treasure. She was very generous in introducing me to her boss, her friends, her art center colleagues. I got a wonderful job for several years in the graduate program at Art Center, and just as a visiting artist. But we just we flew together to the Shippie Gallery where I had a show in New York, and that was in 1987. She met my New Zealand dealer. She just was an extraordinary company to whomever she wanted who she chose. She chose well, but the generosity was extraordinary as a professional mentor. And I gave talks to her student class. She helped in introductions to a New Zealand art show, Three from New Zealand, and Long Beach Museum introduced us to Joan Hugo, who became a very close friend of ours. And I think that her friendship and her love of life, she became a family friend also to my husband and children, my two daughters, Alice and Tasha, who had both been in the United States working. And with my husband, we built had projects and built a home and studio in Venice from 1995 to 2014. And Jacki was always ready for help, advice, or not, but whatever. I am just so grateful for her friendship and celebrating her astonishing life. And I've just been listening to the friends and Margie, and I just find it very, it's sad for me because I've lost her as one of my closest and most loyal friends. But it's the book. This is extraordinary to read this. And she does say something marvelous in the book. And as a daughter of a professor of agricultural science and an environmentalist, there was something that struck a note. Artists are gardeners of the cultural landscape, environmentalists, alchemists, inventors. Well, thank you, Jacki, for everything. You were so funny. We had such fun. And we shared a very bizarre sense of humor, I know. But you were always protective and there when we had troubles. I just adored you. And I will always treasure this and treasure these moments that we had. And thank you for your kindness, your vivid life, well lived, and this very long, sustained friendship that was so rare and precious. Thank you.
Thank you, Philippa Blair. And now we are going to listen to a poem written and voiced by Larry Miller.
A poem which is called It's Jacki. I wrote it for you. It's Jacki. You struck me from the side first as a suddenly appearing thin figure, like a blade cutting and sliding through an otherwise normal atmosphere. Your unannounced presence came into the room as if beginning just ahead of your parting the way. In an electric spark sighting, I can still say you jolted me in that yellow flash preceding you. Your fragrance brought you with it, spelling what you are, not a who. You are an intentional edge of how one could begin choices, being present as an unspoken and freshly offered acquaintance. No old words were needed inside the slight speed in which you changed temperatures, refreshing your unknowable phase shift, a natural occurrence of a creative perimeter, another door through which you had passed. You had appeared, as nature requires of phase shifts in primal matter, made of the substance that is always essential in you. You are Jacki. I could then see you in all the shapes and colors, You are Jacki. I could feel an immutable and transforming, psyche-changing, shifting, rolling with me in tectonic waves, yet holding peripheral orbits around our substance. I remember you ever as you are in a metamorphic shift. Always the same substance, from form to form. You are Jacki, as I always remember you and always love you. Saturday, May 22nd, 2022.
Wow. Thank you, Larry Miller. And now we have Leslie Labowitz-Starris, who's going to read a poem written by Lynn Hickson.
Hello. My goodness, it's so wonderful to see everybody that's here. It's very moving, and I'm sure Jacki would be very happy. So I'm happy to read this from Lynn, who couldn't be here. She, of course, is in Chicago. So here I go. Name your departure, not your destination. The secret is one more step when you arrive. I cannot remember who wrote these words, Jacki. I found them recently in a notebook. But for me, they encapsulate what you taught me as a young artist living and working in LA in the late 70s and early 80s. As my artistic colleague and friend, you were fierce and demanded rigor. You asked questions frankly, and you tackled problems directly. You were always fearless, but fearless with a courageous heart, unafraid to open to the world, to care, no matter what. You created a long-lasting community for us, then based on devotion and commitment. And you had a distinct sense of humor. I will always remember your particular flickering smile. As the writer Helene Cixous writes, and I'm not sure, it's C-I-X-O-U-S, so I'm not sure how to pronounce that, but you all may know her. The junction between the minuscule side and the infinite side produces comic effects almost all the time. I think that laughter is set off when we are not afraid, when we see that the immense is not overwhelming, as the imaginary possibility of taking a mountain in one's arms. This is what you did for us, Jacki. You took us like a mountain in your arms. I will be forever grateful.
And now John Fleck in person speaks for Rudy Perez.
Okay.
Thirdly, our collaboration on Urban Suite, which is an audio that we're going to be listening to soon, for which Jacki wrote the lyrics and narrated with music by Tom Rashan, performed at Dance Academy West in 1984. When I think of this piece, it brings tears to my eyes, an emotional rush of that special occasion. I thank Jacki for that. So, listen.
Flying time is 5 hours and 19 minutes from New York to LA. And in between, there are people in houses eating dinner, watching the evening news on TV, recounting the details of a day not very different from the one before, but different nonetheless. At the moment, they are thinking about breadsticks and cheese and what they are going to drink. She is thinking about the messages on her phone machine and conspicuous absences. He is planning his strategy for tomorrow's meeting. In between, people make arrangements, cross streets, encounter the unexpected and unplanned. the moment, a man approaches him from a dark doorway and asks for his money. She is thinking about whether she should change jobs.
That was a sampling.
Yay. Yeah. Thank you, Rudy Perez and Jacki Apple for the urban suite. All right. And next, in the flesh, Eric Gutierrez.
I think it's great that we're here at Highways, the Arts Complex, because this was the place, Highways is where performance art really took off in the West in a way that Jacki was indisputably one of the biggest champions for. That, you know, that being said, I still had to dress up because it's Jacki, right? She was very clear when you went out that we weren't going to be going wearing sweats. Okay, so I'm not gonna speak about Jacki as an artist or as a teacher or because my relationship with Jacki was one of her editor at High Performance Magazine back when I was executive editor and Jacki was helping us all formulate a language about how to speak about this genre at a time when major newspapers like the LA Times were sending theater reviewers to write about performance art. And then they would, their articles would be about, the reviews would be about how bad the acting was. And I have to say, I was when I first got the gig and Jacki was a contributing editor and I knew she was gonna be doing features for us and whatnot, I had been warned by some nameless people that Jacki could be challenging. What I found is that I don't know if she had never been edited before or if she just was not going to be edited by me. That being said, Jacki and I, we butted heads in the beginning, and yet we ended up having an odd sadomasochistic affection for each other. The fact of the matter is that Jacki was not difficult. She was exacting. Jacki insisted on excellence. She wanted it in herself. She wanted it in the artist she championed. She wanted it in the way we spoke about this work. She had the context. She had the intellect. She had the long view of performance art as an important genre of work that had to be spoken about not as an ancillary part of some other genre like theater or installation or dance, as admirable and important as they are. But she helped us develop a language. She gave a vocabulary and she did this in such a way that was exacting and demanded more of all of us. She really did demand a lot of us. But No one celebrated or supported the success and the artists like Jacki Apple. Now, I don't know how many of you have picked up recently your copy of Performance Media Art and Art Culture. Pick it up again. When John said earlier that you die twice, once when you take your last breath and once when people stop saying your name. Jacki Apple's name is one that we should all be referencing and that art history needs to really grapple with her ideas, really grapple with the way that she spoke about the important and vital work that we do. One of the greatest moments of my career, honestly, happened at her 80th birthday party last year. Jacki, and she looked like $1 million. She pulled it out of the hat and she looked fantastic. And it was this beautiful small gathering at the home of John Fleck and Randy Laborde. And it had some of the luminaries and the lights and the people who were dearest to her, who were able to make it to town. And we had a moment together and she said, "We did some good work together, Eric." And I said, "Yeah, we did, Jacki." And she said, "We worked well together." And I said, "Well, that's not how I remember it." But the great thing, and this is the thing that sticks with me, Jacki never stopped working. I was in awe of... I was in awe of this person who let this young punk, pretty much right out of college, edit her. And here she is, still creatively vibrant, intellectually curious, and I must say, ultimately, such a kick to know. Love to Jacki.
Thank you, Eric Gutierrez. That was beautiful. All right. And now we have Meredith Monk, who will be performing Happy Woman.
I think I'm supposed to speak a little bit before.
And now Meredith Monk will speak before performing Happy Woman. Sorry about that, Meredith.
That's okay. No problem at all. I always knew about Jacki Apple when she was in New York and in Los Angeles, but I never had the pleasure of meeting her until 2019, when the Los Angeles Philharmonic put on a production of my opera Atlas, directed by Yuval Sharon, and it was the first time that my work had ever been directed by anybody else. And Jacki, through my dear friend Ping Chong, contacted me and wanted to have lunch with me. And so we had lunch, and I think we talked about 3 or 4 hours. I mean, we just were going to town. We had such a wonderful time, and it was so vibrant to be with her. She was so incredibly clear-eyed. Her integrity was so deep, and her insights she gave me a lot of insight about her response to the production, and a lot to think about that I took with me for many, many months. And we stayed in touch with each other these years. And she sent me a beautiful review of my piece, Cellular Songs, that I had done before I met her in Los Angeles. And I was so struck by the depth of her understanding of what I was trying to do and what all artists are trying to do, and the depth of her vision and her clear-eyed honesty. And I had the privilege of speaking with her a few days before she left us. And again, I was just so struck by her realness, by her complete honesty, clear-eyed honesty, clear vision, complete clear vision to the very end. So this piece, Happy Woman, I worked on during the pandemic, and I sent this video to her, and she really loved it. It is a part of Cellular Songs. And I originally wrote it thinking about it being a representation of all women, but I think it's also a representation of all the different aspects of women. And certainly Jacki had many, many aspects. So this is my offering to Jacki.
Oh, I'm a happy woman, I'm a happy woman. Oh, I'm a happy woman, I'm a happy woman. Oh, I'm a happy woman, I'm a happy woman. Oh, I'm a happy woman, I'm a happy woman. Oh, I'm a happy woman, I'm a happy woman. Oh, I'm a happy woman, I'm a happy woman. Oh, I'm a happy woman, I'm a happy woman. Oh, I'm a happy woman, I'm a happy woman. Oh, I'm a hungry woman, I'm a hungry woman. Oh, I'm a hungry woman, I'm a hungry woman. Oh, I'm a hungry woman, I'm a hungry woman. Oh, I'm a hungry woman, I'm a hungry woman. Hey, you, ha, ha, hey, ha. Hey, you, ha, ha, ha. Hey, you, ha, ha, hey, ha. Hey, you, ha, ha, ha. Hey, you, ha, ha, hey, ha. Hey, you, ha, ha, ha. Oh.
thinking woman, I'm a thinking woman. Oh, I'm a sassy woman, I'm a sassy woman. Oh, I'm a patient woman, I'm a patient woman. Oh, I'm a thieving woman, I'm a thieving woman. Oh, I'm a grieving woman, I'm a grieving woman. Oh, I'm a shaky woman, I'm a shaky woman. Oh, I'm a lucky woman, I'm a lucky woman. Oh, I'm a needy woman, I'm a needy woman. Oh, I'm a greedy woman, I'm a greedy woman. Hey, you, ha, ha, ha. Hey, you, ha, ha, hey, ha. Hey, you, ha, ha, ha. Hey, you, ha, ha, hey, ha. Hey, you, ha, ha, ha. Hey, you, ha. Hey, you, ha, ha, ha. Oh, I'm a quiet woman, I'm a quiet woman. Oh, I'm a quiet woman, I'm a quiet woman. Oh, I'm an angry woman, I'm an angry woman. Oh, I'm an angry woman, I'm an angry woman. Oh, I'm an honest woman, I'm an honest woman. Oh, I'm an honest woman, I'm an honest woman. Oh, I'm a lying woman, I'm a lying woman.
Thank you, Meredith. That was beautiful. And now, all right, we have Stuart Jackson Hughes coming on up to the podium.
Good afternoon. Feels terribly presumptuous to be speaking after such a lineup of tremendous speakers. Never mind the last performance. I can't help but mention that one of the words that's been used for Jacki, coming straight from Margie and her husband, actually, was the word feisty. And I was waiting throughout the entire performance for that word to come up, and it almost did. It almost did. So Margie and I have been co-conspirators. She was going to speak to the very earliest years of Jacki's life, and I was going to speak to those years which were so central in my own life. In the late 70s. We've been very good friends ever since. And if I may, I'll read a little bit from this text and speak up. It would not be the first time I was told to do that. My parents used to say, could you mumble that again, please? When Jacki recently turned 80 and I had just hit 70, we became truly old friends, spanning almost 45 years. Quite an honor, quite a thought. Hard to sum up in just a few minutes. Jacki's Joshua Tree headstone, an engraved small desert boulder, sums up her essence in three words: artist, mentor, friend. It really does. Margie wrote that, so succinct, it's brilliant. It is followed by an origami bird, Emily Waters' choice, capturing Jacki's Japanese aesthetics perfectly. For me, I knew two Jackies, the young, sophisticated, romantic, and vulnerable woman of the early years, and Jacki, the evolving, consummate professional, an inspired multimedia artist, radio personality, critic, and wordsmith par excellence, a little use of French for her grandmother, by the way. Nationally honored professor, institutional memory of contemporary ephemeral arts, and the personification of aesthetic excellence and boundless insight. Need I mention perfect hair? Am I given to hyperbole? Let me refer you to John Fleck's terrific interview at Lace at the launch of Jacki's Selected Essays, 1984-2018. Haven't seen it yet? Well, you must. He begins by spoofing an opera diva, singing Jacki's praises to the skies, as our own diva comes laughing onto the stage. Her reading and Q&A is a tour de force. That is the later Jacki, an intellectual powerhouse, prophetic persona, an oracle, said John. Our friendship goes back to 1978 and the people and events of the Mexican Tapes, one of Jacki's first multimedia pieces. Its catalyst or agent provocateur was Peter Bartlett, my colleague at the Australian Embassy in Mexico City at the time. He had invited Jacki to that ancient metropolis. He was multi-layered, multifaceted, energetic, erudite, intellectually ambitious, later a PhD candidate with the famed Committee on Social Thought at the University of Chicago, obviously going to be somewhat of interest to Jacki. Peter could be rather British, and he was a budding playwright. He loved role-playing in a diplomatic world that demanded as much. He was the brother I needed just then, and perhaps the lover Jacki yearned for. Peter was sexually ambiguous, I should say. His public persona and his inner truth were not much synchronized. He had learned to mask his true self, and that is the inner theme of the Mexican Tapes. Jacki loved Peter, and he loved her, but it also proved inevitably an emotional crucible for her. Before they met, Peter had bought Slep Castle, the most haunted place in Central Ireland. Jacki and I both helped restore parts of it. We both loved the Gothic strength of the place, and its turbulent history in Ireland still in turmoil then. Sadly, Peter was to die of AIDS in 1989, and his ashes were spread below the castle's massive walls. Jacki and I went to Chicago to make his quilt, an image of Lep at its center, and I later read his name over a small sea of quilts in San Francisco. Tough thing to do, actually, as it is tough to be here today. Jacki's humanity. I'm told that's classic Canadian humor. It's almost always unintended. Jacki's humanity is what held us tight over the years. She was about much more than artistic creativity, condensed analysis, or the arduous business of getting us to save our planet. Jacki was all about living up to one's potential, about empathy and compassion, fair play, letting others have a voice. She avoided labels like gender or race. She looked for intrinsic worth. She also loved animals, as many have noted. When her fate was already sealed, I asked her why she didn't get another cat. She looked at me slightly appalled. She often did that, actually, but we won't go into that. The cat would bond with me, and I would soon abandon it. That's a terrible thing to do. That's Jacki. She understood leadership. She cared deeply. One evening, leaving a play by a member of this audience, well, we actually know who that is. It's over there. She explained that she was going to review it for an important publication. The clock was ticking. I asked why that should be her top priority just then. Because he has never had the recognition he deserves. She said, emphatically, always in character, New Horizons. Jacki tracked my Foreign Service postings, and we explored New York, San Francisco, Turkey, Central America, even Cambodia and Vietnam. She loved the complex layered history of Turkey and all that fresh food. She took my portrait in a 2,500-year-old Lycian sarcophagus overlooking the turquoise coast, Bidiri, but I believe it's out there in the exhibition. And teaching children in Cappadocia the rudiments of painting, they followed her around like the Pied Piper, and she adored them. In Costa Rica, she marveled at the ecological riot of a tropical forest. In Cambodia, the sublime and the horrific were two sides of the same coin. We had the beauty of Angkor Wat almost to ourselves, and the aftermath of the Vietnam War most everywhere else. It was there that I learned how transformative Jacki could be simply by stating what was obvious to her. Bear in mind, she was a good friend of Spalding Gray and admired his one-man show, Swimming to Cambodia. After a few days, I said there was something that really bothered me about Cambodia, but I couldn't put my finger on it. She gave me that look again. You do realize, don't you, that there is no one our age here. Pol Pot had murdered an entire generation. Their ghosts were everywhere. It's hard doing this. Jacki left us a legacy of her work. Her selected essays is meant to serve coming generations. But there's one project that needs a few finishing touches to see the light of day. A postscript and sequel to the Mexican tapes. Emily has been instrumental in bringing it to life. I don't think it is a coincidence that Jacki returns to that crucible in her last work. Although there is only one shroud, I suspect the shadows of two souls are down there in Joshua Tree, where our two Jackies are one. Sorry. Jackie's life was fully, richly fulfilled. She earned every bit of it. My sister in spirit and such a force for good. We all thank you, Jacki, for your embrace, for so enriching our lives. But really, did you have to set the bar quite so high for the rest of us? Thank you.
Thank you, Stuart. And now we have Sheila Pinkle coming up to the podium.
Well, I'm getting shorter, you know. Okay, that's great. That's perfect. Thank you. I first met Jacki when she did a performance in a venue on Robertson Boulevard in the late 1970s. I believe that this was a sound and narrative work based on an early iteration of the Mexican tapes. She was poised, glamorous, articulate. I was mesmerized by the powerful and poetic intersections of history, politics, and personal narrative. We formed a deep connection that continued until the present time, our lives intersecting sporadically but significantly. I was always impressed by the breadth of her vision, which included physics, astronomy, philosophy, ecology, gender issues, history, and politics in multidimensional performances and writings. Jacki was deeply committed to new music and sound art and was an innovative force in using the vehicle of radio in order to manifest her own works and communicate the works of the next generation of sound and music artists. From 1982 to 1995, she produced the program Soundings on KPFK Radio, facilitating the communication of works by hundreds of sound and performance artists at a time when there was no other consistent venue representing their works. Her generosity in representing artists and ideas in writing continued until 1 month before she passed, as she continued to publish multiple articles online. Periodically, Jacki and I would have dinner, during which I would hear all about her other life as an academic. She taught at Art Center School of Design for many years, where she was a beloved and inspirational teacher. She also became the mouthpiece for the faculty fighting with the administration for better wages and working conditions. Over many dinners, I heard about the next installment of issues. Another example of her willingness to fight for people and ideas. At one point, Rachel Rosenthal invited us to have dinner with her at her studio. The occasion was that Rachel, who had a lifelong battle with her weight, had a dinner to celebrate that she was never going to eat sweets again. I think we had chocolate cake for dessert. This was going to be the last sweet Rachel ever had. Of course, she lived next to an incredible bakery, and so Jacki and I weren't sure how long this commitment was going to last. I was surprised when Jacki recommended that I write reviews for art science exhibitions at the Williamson Gallery at Art Center. It never occurred to me that she understood that I had the capacity to do this, but that was Jacki. She had a profound love for and understanding of the people in her sphere and created opportunities for them whenever she could. The last time I saw Jacki was a week before she passed. She was quite ill, could barely speak, and I only came to briefly say hello. For the next 2 hours, she told me about the background for the Mexican tapes and the wild experiences she had had when she innocently met a friend in Mexico City in the mid-1970s. She was determined to finish this work based on those experiences. Even at that late stage in her illness, she looked like an elegant, fashionable Jacki who mesmerized me once again. She has a special place in my heart. She knows what knew what to be, what it meant to be a true friend, and I am personally richer for having known her.
Thank you, Sheila. And now we have Ulysses Jenkins here in person coming up to the stage.
Ah, yes. Yeah, I know about that. What a moment, what a time. I see a lot of people I've met over the years, through the years, some of them I've actually collaborated with. And of course, Jacki Apple. Meeting Margie was just a treat because she reminded me so much of Jacki. And for me, even as people have been talking about the Mexican tapes, that was one of the first performances that I collaborated with Jacki on the audio for the performance. And then again, a piece that I haven't heard too many people speak of today, The Garden Planet. I was a collaborator with her in The Garden Planet, and we did it at Rachel Rosenthal's. And I would say this to you today, Jacki. They're going to the moon again. And she and I used to have lots of talks about outer space and the significance of The Garden Planet Revisited, as she had titled it. A very interesting piece, too, and she was at the time pointing to the ecology. What are we doing? What are we not doing? And actually, in that performance, I actually had the, I will call it the great opportunity to dance solo with Anna Homler. I've worked with Jacki for so many years indirectly, just in terms of conversation. A lot of people here, I don't want to copy what they've said, but for the most part, I would say this, if you were a friend of Jacki Apple's, a true friend, it was generally for life. And it was very difficult for me to even try to talk to her in her last days. For the last few years, she helped myself and Deborah Oliver create a program at UC Irvine for performance, where we presented Rudy Perez, his last company here, where we presented Kate Newland creating Rachel's work. And of course, Jacki would open the show with her brilliance and her commentaries about the world of performance. I would say this, meeting Jacki at the time that I met her at the beginning of what became performance art in LA was just an amazing time. I hope one day, and I know Jackie's written about it, but I hope one day someone will realize, actually, I was talking to Suzanne Lacey back there. People don't seem to recognize, unfortunately, today we've gotten so segregated. We all used to get together, folks. And Jacki was one of the instruments of bringing us together. I've wanted to do and say more, but I really was difficult coming to this. And I'll just sing a line from one of my audio pieces, just very brief. That she's so beautiful with the blues. Thank you.
Thank you, Ulysses. She's so beautiful. Okay, oops, watch your step, buddy. Yeah.
I got it. Thank you, John.
Okay, great to see you.
It was good to see you too, man. Or seeing you.
Oh, put it that way. I know. We're not segregated today, baby. Okay. Okay, coming up. Oh, we're going to the East Coast here, zooming in on Casey Parsons. Hello, Casey.
Hi.
Hi.
Can you see me? It's a little dark. All right. Hi. I just want to thank my mom, who has been working really hard on producing this event for a while since Jacki passed. And I know that there were a lot of other people involved in making this happen. So thank you guys for bringing everybody together and celebrating this Jacki's life. And Emily, who I haven't met yet, but I heard a lot about from Jacki. I was working kind of in a similar role to Emily before Emily. When I first graduated from college, I was working as her kind of archival assistant after having known Jacki my whole life, as a family friend and mentor to my mom and myself and my whole family. And it was really amazing to go through Jacki's work right when I kind of was coming into adulthood and see just how prolific she was and how on top of the environmental, fight for climate justice she was. And she was so inspirational to me as a thought partner. And she was always talking to me like an adult, even when I was three. She wasn't three, but when I was three, she would talk to me like I was an adult. And she would tell me, I don't like kids very much, but I like you. And so that was kind of our dynamic. And I really felt like she just was a natural teacher. And, she was always trying to get me to be more expressive in my style. And, she would just lead by example, but also was a very deep thinker who could engage in these wonderful conversations that I'll remember about, past lives and what happens after you die. And those were things I was thinking about when I saw her before she passed. And it was so wonderful to see her because she was so present and so awake, even up until those final moments. And that was such a gift because that fearlessness is really who she was. And I know all of us experienced that being close to her. And I'll always remember her as this fearless, fearless woman who just spread love with the care that she poured into her relationship. So thank you, Jacki. And thanks for having me tonight.
Thanks, Casey. And now, coming up to the podium is Emily. Emily Waters, ladies and gentlemen.
I have to say, it's so amazing having everyone here. You know, Jacki, she had this idea like a couple years ago, she was gonna have like a big 80th birthday, like retrospective bash. But between the pandemic and chemo, it just never happened. So in a way, that's kind of what this is. So having us all together celebrating her life and her work. So yeah, it's also a little crazy meeting everyone because many of you have heard about me from Jacki, and I have heard many stories about everyone here. You know, I know a lot of the names, I just haven't seen the faces. And I've also been hearing her half of phone conversations for years. Yes, one of the things that was really fascinating with Jacki is, you know, she shared so much of herself with me, you know, so many of her stories and her experiences. She didn't just know art history, she lived it. I, you know, there were parts of her that she shared with me. And it sort of changed and grew from when I was her student at Art Center and eventually her TA, and when I was her protege and her archivist and eventually her friend. In the past, she would tailor the information that she gave to me. But eventually, she sort of became an open book with me. I could ask her anything about her life, and she would have a story for me. Part of why we started the Mexican Tapes book was because I got to read her journals and see the slides that she took. And I was so enamored by this side of Jacki that I had never seen before. And I think that she was so excited by me being excited about it, that it really drove her to write more and to make the book. And there's days that I want to call her up, but I want to ask her questions. And I want to hear another story. In a way, I still can. You know, she's left her journals and her photos and notes and letters. You know, those stories are still there. I just have to sort through and find them myself. For the last few years, I feel like Jacki and I have been tethered together. As much as she relied on me, I relied on her. I find myself untethered and unmoored. And I've terrifyingly come to realize that not only have I lost my mentor, I've lost my normal. I've lost my everyday. But Jacki, the ever practical and pragmatic one, has left me with a plethora of projects to finish. I have to finish her papers for the Fail Archive at NYU. Her work will also be shown at the James Gallery at the Graduate Center in CUNY next month. We'll be showing works from Redefining Democracy in America, Garden Planet Revisited, and also Voices in the Dark. I also, Stuart, will be helping me finish the Mexican Tapes book that Jacki and I started together. And I hope that many more books will be written about Jacki by future scholars and art historians. Jacki had many titles for me, but she also called me her heir. At first jokingly, and then not so jokingly, she realized something that I'm just starting to wrap my brain around now. I've become the guardian of her legacy, of her history in the public, you know, in public memory. Jacki may have left, but I know her stories will live on in me and everyone here, and in her artworks and in her writings. And I hope that I can help her live on in everyone that learns her name, so that she truly will never be forgotten. Thank you all so much for coming out. It's really wonderful having everyone here. Thank you.
Thank you, Emily. And now we have Julie Adler.
Just want to make sure. I lost my voice. Okay, it's back. I hate to be the one to close this out in a way, because it's been so amazing. And I just want to say one. I was driving back from visiting my mom, and my first phone call for many years has been to Jacki right after visiting my mom. And it was always met with why did you do that again? And then we would roll out the whole debrief, and it was so helpful, and I miss that. I miss her so much. To end, Deborah asked for a prayer, and this is it's the Heart Sutra, the words of the Buddha, and what's special about this is that this was read to Jacki right before, on the day of her passing. She wanted to kind of create that space. I mean, she'd been creating that space for a long time, and she loved practice, being associated to Buddhism. If you asked her, oh, you know, are you going on retreat? I'm kind of like a Buddhist fanatic a little bit. And she would be like, why do you have to go on retreat all the time? So there was this love for it. We talked about a lot together. And I know that she went regularly to meditation, and she also came sometimes with me to Joshua Tree to meet one of my teachers. And so she wanted a Buddhist inspired departure. So this was a real important part of it. And so I'm going to read the text, and this will close it for us. So all of us together, listening to the words of the Buddha, and Jacki's here. Please be here. She said that she would always be here for all of us in her way. This particular translation is by Kazuaki Tanahashi and Roshi Joan Halifax. And in whatever way you want to be present, here we go. Avalokiteshvara, Buddha of compassion, who helps us all to awaken, moves in the deep course of realizing wisdom beyond wisdom, sees that all five streams of body, heart, and mind are without boundary, and frees all from anguish. O Shariputra, who listens to the teachings of the Buddha, form is not separate from boundlessness. Boundlessness is not separate from form. Form is boundlessness. Boundlessness is form. Feelings, perceptions, inclinations, and discernment are also like this. O Shariputra, boundlessness is the nature of all things. It neither arises or perishes, neither stains nor purifies, neither increases nor decreases. Boundlessness is not limited by form, nor by feelings, perceptions, inclinations, or discernment. It is free of the eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body, and mind, free of sight, sound, smell, taste, touch, and any object of mind, free of sensory realms, including the realm of the mind. It is free of ignorance and the end of ignorance. Boundlessness is free of old age and death, and free of the end of old age and death. It is free of suffering, arising, cessation, and path, and free of wisdom and attainment. Being free of attainment, those who help all to awaken abide in the realization of wisdom beyond wisdom, and live with an unhindered mind. Without hindrance, the mind has no fear. Free from confusion, those who lead all to liberation embody profound serenity. All those in the past, present, and future who realize wisdom beyond wisdom manifest unsurpassable and thorough awakening. Know that realizing wisdom beyond wisdom is no other than this wondrous mantra, luminous, unequaled, and supreme. It relieves all suffering. It is genuine, not illusory. So set forth this mantra of realized wisdom beyond wisdom. Set forth this mantra that says, gate, gate, paragate, parasamgatye bodhi svaha. I'm going to do that two more times because my teacher liked to do that two more times. Gate, it means to go and then go beyond and go beyond beyond. Paragate, parasamgate, bodhi, svaha. Gate, paragate, parasamgate, bodhi, svaha. And as an addendum to this, just imagine us all with Jacki now. May you be filled with light, and may you be free of all suffering, and may you be at peace. May you be filled with light, the light that has been sent to you over the years by all the people you love and those who love you. The light that comes from your deep faith, the light at the very core of your being that you share with all beings. The light that you may see waiting for you as you get closer to that which separates this world from the next. May you be free of all suffering, the suffering that your illness has brought to your body, the suffering of anticipating a time that your family will be without you, the suffering of missed opportunities in the past or memories of times that you weren't able to live up to your highest expectations for yourself. And may you be at peace, the peace that comes to all of us from accepting that we have done the best we could in our lives. The peace of knowing that you were loved and have freely given your love to others. The peace of letting go of that body that sustains you but must be left behind. The peace of moving into the fullness of your communion with the divine. May you be filled with light. May you be free of suffering, all suffering, and may you be at peace. Thank you, Jacki.
Thank you, Julie. Gate. Here's Deborah right here. Where are you, Deborah? Here you are. Come on, where are you going, Deborah? Okay. You got something to say?
Hi, John.
Hi, how are you doing?
I am truly moved by everybody's presence here. She was a shining light, and I saw her 2 days before she passed, and her eyes were still bright. And she knew she had other work to do. And she was fearlessly facing it. I don't understand it, but I saw it in her eyes, and her holding my hand saying, make my memorial for me. She wanted to party with everybody. She wanted to see everyone. She wanted to shine light on everyone. And she knew that she had to say goodbye here and go do. And she knew she was going to do in this other place. And carry her words, carry her sound, carry her wisdom, carry everything she learned from us and that we were able to give to her. And anyway, we are now going to have a toast to Jacki, which is champagne glasses are being filled behind you. And we're going to whisk them down to you. And Margie and John are going to say a toast to Jacki. And thank you all for your incredible words, your songs, your prayers, just everything. And
also, let's thank these guys.
Oh, Bruce! Oh, my gosh! Zoom thing, hybrid.
John
over there. And there's so many.
To the gallery.
Yes. And Leo Mayhair's amazing highways for very many years. Everybody worked together to make this all happen. And Leslie and Emily and Jackie's sister, who will just got to get around her because she emanates their doppelgangers. And thank you, Margie. So, and again, we're going to have our champagne. And then please note, you can walk into the gallery and into the performance space. And there's a montage of images of Jacki performing, some from Highways, and her music, her words, and her prints are hanging up for us to have more memories and thoughts of her. And now Margie's going to have a toast, and we're going to hand out some champagne glasses.
Actually, first, what I want to do is I want to take a moment, and I'd like to thank Deborah Oliver for her and her team for the extraordinary effort she put into this amazing tribute to Jacki. Thank you. And to Emily Waters for facilitating it so efficiently. I would also like to thank all Jacki's friends and colleagues who paid tribute to her here on Zoom. And finally, I would like to thank the 100+ people around the world who joined us to celebrate Jacki. You are all amazing. And we all thank you for coming here today. And then I will wait for my champagne. Oh, thank you.
Okay, slowly but surely. Okay.
Thank you so much.
It was wonderful because you really touched on a lot of this. Oh,
thank you so much. And I appreciate your remarks too.
Okay, does everyone have their champagne? Not yet? Well, we'll have to wait.
I can talk about the Cooney show
while we have downtime. Okay,
why don't you do your thing?
Yeah, my toast is very
short. I just wanted to say, for those of you who didn't know about the upcoming show in New York next month, for anyone who is in New York or, you know, happen to be going around there. Yes, for the people on Zoom and everyone. So Jacki will be part of a show that's at the Cooney Graduate Center. The opening is September 21st, and there also will be a public discussion about Jacki and her legacy on October 3rd. And I'm going to send out an email to everyone that we invited to the memorial so that they have the information as well. But, you know, Jacki really wanted to be there. You know, we had planned, you know, that she was going to be there, but it ended up not happening. But yeah, for those on the East Coast who couldn't be here, you might be able to go over there. So there already are multiple people that I know on the New York side who will be joining us over there. So yeah, I think do we all have our champagne here? The show runs until, so it physically opens to the public September 13th, though the actual opening reception is the 21st, and then it goes until November, it might be November 13th, so I think it's 2 months. So yes, and there are going to be, they'll be showing The Garden Planet Revisited, Redefining Democracy in America, Part 1, episodes in black and white, and also Voices in the Dark. And we've digitized photographs, documentation of these performances, and we will have recordings of these performances playing. So it's been something that Jacki had been organizing for a few months, and it's now, it's actually happening. So hopefully it's, you know, it is spreading the word of Jacki Apple. So, yeah.
And for you, Ulysses, it's garden.
Yeah, it's, it is. It is the garden.
It's the garden planet.
I just finished digitizing all these photos of you.
Well, this is hard for me to do.
Okay, you want me to hold something?
A toast to an indomitable force, my sister Jacki Apple, artist, mentor, friend. You have enriched the life of everyone you knew. You made a difference. To Jacki.
Jacki!
Woo!
Deborah? Thank you guys. To Jacki. To Jacki. Enjoy, enjoy. Jacki, she's here. All right, go mingle and look at her beautiful face and words. Thank you, everyone. Oh, Julie. Oh, Linda. Oh, Elijah. I'm just going to say everybody's name. Okay, Bruce.
Bye, baby. See you around. Didn't I tell you I wouldn't hold you down? Take good care of yourself, you're here. Don't let me hear about you shedding a tear. You're gonna make it. You're gonna make it. Remember me as a sunny day that you once had.